Hello everyone, welcome to this live stream from the Bird Nest, and today we are going to talk about food delivery services, right? I'm using this guy here to order food, and every time I get charged so much money that I cannot keep up, right? So we are going to change that through blockchain technology. Let's see our video first, and we'll be back shortly.
Welcome to the Bird Nest.
Cool. And at this point, I would like to welcome and say good morning to my friend, my dear friend, Jimmy. Hey, man, how are you?
Good morning, Hercules. Nice to see you again.
All good? All good. And at this point, I would like to welcome also Bas Ross. He is the CEO of Bistru.io. Welcome to our family, Bas.
Thank you, guys. Happy to be here.
How are you? How is the weather there? I see sunshine.
Yeah, but that's a little misguiding, but it's sunshine and raining on the same time, simultaneously. The Netherlands, yeah, it's a rainy country.
Yeah, got it. I mean, it's not the best, but hey. So we are broadcasting at the same time on YouTube and Twitter. So guys, if you have any questions around Bistru or you know how the platform works, please go ahead, leave your comments on the chat, and we'll make sure to ask the question to Bas. So just to start, would you like to give us a brief introduction to yourself, how you started with crypto, and then we will go into more in depth how you started with Bistru?
Yeah, gotcha, for sure. So my name is Bas. I'm a 30-year-old entrepreneur from the Netherlands. I was schooled as an MBA, and I got into like my first job after graduating over at EY, Ernst & Young. And what I did there was like analyzing big ERP systems. So my job was to validate the data within these ERP systems in like a highly automated business process environment all over the globe, with like billions of transactions usually. But like these systems always had some sort of frustration with me, especially on like the database level. Where data could be modified or adjusted or managed by people with certain authorizations. So that was also always frustrating me a little bit in that process of doing my work. And then I came into contact with blockchain technology somewhere around 2015. And then I realized that blockchain technology was basically a technology that was addressing these frustrations. So the way we store or transfer data in such a like independent and neutral, transparent way without the ability to modify it afterwards, that really got me going. So basically that's how I got into blockchain, and if you get into blockchain, you'll get into crypto as well. So from then on, I've been working as like a independent entrepreneur, as an advisor or a consultant, rather to say. And I've been talking to a lot of business teams and a lot of executive teams about digital transformation and how blockchain technology could potentially be a strategic way for a lot of companies to optimize these processes.
Got it. And it sounds very impressive. You must be a very smart guy.
Yeah, I don't know. I have fun doing my job, and I do it with a lot of passion. And I like to innovate a lot. So that's basically why I decided to become an entrepreneur. So innovation is definitely very important for me. And when you work for big companies, that's not always a possibility due to all sorts of reasons. So, innovative and passionate for sure. Yeah.
And I was very impressed when we first talked, because Bistru is also one of our partners at the Bird Nest, and it's great to have you guys in the family. And if you had 2 minutes, right, to talk about Bistru, and let me share my screen as well to show the website, how would you sell it to me, let's say. We've spoken about this before,
like you said, but like our biggest frustration in like looking at the food market or other markets in general, but specifically the food market for us, is the way it's centralized. Like there's parties just dominating every aspect of the chain. For example, if you look at restaurants, there's these centralized parties dominating everything within like the market, meaning they have all the customer contact, they have all the customer data, they have all the payments, they have all the transactions, control on all the transactions. They dictate everything towards like a merchants. So for example, they control all the menus, they control all the promotions, they control all the pricings. So either way you look at it, like towards a consumer level or towards a merchant level, there's this centralized party in the middle that completely dictates and controls the market. And basically effectively eliminating the possibility of restaurants to directly commerce or trade with their customers, or even build up loyalty towards their direct customers. So what we try to build with Bistro, what we're actually building and launching, is a commerce protocol, a direct to consumer commerce protocol, for merchants to directly do commerce or conduct trade with their merchants. So we've launched this platform in the Netherlands as like a launching market last year in March, pre-COVID. We've been working on this pre-COVID, but then COVID just shook up the market. And we were very happy that we were able to onboard a numerous of clients and really start the first traction of the platform in our launching market, as is the Netherlands. And we're about to move to Belgium later this year. And next year, we're about to launch Bistro.com, which is our global platform as a service utility, fully validated as a product and fully optimized as a product for scaling and international usage.
And I personally like the approach that you have here, because you are starting, let's say, locally. You didn't launch Bistro.io and say, okay, let's conquer the world, right? Straight ahead. You chose to start in your country first to see how this will go, I guess, and then you know, you expand later on.
Yeah, exactly. Because like in crypto and in blockchain, usually it's the other way around. You do exactly. White paper first, and you launch the token first, and then you build the product. We basically did it on like a the Dutch way, I guess. Maybe it's something like that. But we built the platform as a proved concept first. We launched the platform because the platform is obviously the fundamental of it all, and it should be ready to grow. It should be ready to operate. So we launched it in the Netherlands. We went to 200 merchants fairly quickly, and we're still growing almost to 300 merchants right now. We have 23,000 active users almost right now, and we sold over $1 million of food in like the first months, and we're growing again this year. Obviously the market was shook up by COVID a lot, but that gave us also the opportunity to really optimize the product. So mm-hmm. We've been working closely together with like the first 200 launching customers to really optimize the dashboards, to really optimize the back office, and really make it a protocol first approach, because it's very important for us that the merchant is in full control. So everything that has to do with their company policy or policy of selling stuff, you know, terms and conditions is the word that I was looking for, should be facilitated within their back office environment, in their dashboard environment. And that's what we're currently thriving on. Restaurants are not used to having that much control in this market, and are really satisfied by the level of autonomy they get through these systems. That helped us validate the product even more, get the traction we need. And currently we're in the process of adjusting it in such a capacity that it's scalable on a global scale.
So how, tell me about the pandemic, because you mentioned the pandemic two times, and how did it affect the business? Did it boost you back a bit with delivery of the product, or you had or it was overwhelming for you? You had many clients coming in because actually food stores were looking for a way to work, right? They couldn't have dining
clients.
Yeah, I
guess it was a little bit of both. However, we didn't fall behind on like the roadmap. We just kept following the operational planning and the development planning we had, and we were able to do so. But the other thing you mentioned, it was very overwhelming at first as well, because we had a very small team at the beginning when launching the product, and then we immediately jumped to like a lot of active merchants with a lot of priority on this market, because like they couldn't receive customers within their stores, so everybody was focused on takeaway and delivery. So there was a really high level of priority for this market to be launched. So with the small team we had at that time, it was really a challenge. But we were able to attract a lot of good new team members in the process, and currently we are already for the next steps. The thing what is a little bit like how do you say it, a little bit unclear about like the COVID thing is like things have changed on a weekly basis, right? So for example, in the Netherlands we have been coming out of lockdown lately. But the last week or the last few days, it might be not going in the right direction in numbers of infections, and rules have been changed again. So on a daily basis, basically, or on a weekly basis, the market variables or market parameters can change, and we need to be highly adaptive to it. But I think our system, in essence, is designed for such adaptiveness. But it does impose challenges, but we're handling them greatly right now. We're handling them correctly. Yeah,
that's good. That's good. And Jimmy, my colleague at the Burp Nest, he is based in Netherlands, and I'm sure he's downloading the app as we speak.
Well, no, not as we speak. I already downloaded.
Okay.
I know.
Nice.
I like the app. It's pretty clear. You know, the funny thing is, one of the main players when it comes to the food delivery sector in the Netherlands is Thuisbezorgd. Yes. And Thuisbezorgd, it was brought into existence because the CEO, Jitse Groen, he was really, annoyed and frustrated that he couldn't order food at any given time. So that was his main frustration. But now this frustration moved from him to a lot of other restaurant holders or restaurant owners, because if you want to be part of Thuisbezorgd or any other big food delivery providers, you need to pay a lot of commission, right? And sometimes it's even 10 up to 15% commission you need to pay to the Thuisbezorgd and Uber Eats and all these other big players in this market. So what's actually the main benefit right now for normal restaurant owner to use BistroNL platform or Bistro platform compared with Thuisbezorgd and Uber Eats and all these other big players?
And that is a very good question. And that is a very good question. And with that in mind, I will show this comparison table as well. I think it's quite useful, right?
It is, yeah. So like you mentioned, we read a lot of frustration in the markets, like especially on the merchant level. So they feel they're kind of locked in a certain type of vendor lock-in, where they are basically dictated by their service provider. So meaning the service provider controls their menus, the service provider controls their promotions in some cases, they control their payments or even payouts, they control the user data and the customer relationship. So on every aspect, this merchant is basically losing its autonomy and having to pay a decent fee for that in the process as well. So we learned a couple of years back that there was a lot of frustration in this, in especially like Europe and in the Netherlands for this model. And that made us come up with the idea of Bistro. where the restaurant owner is always in full control. So our mantra is kind of like, we facilitate and never dictate. So everything should be in the protocol, and everything should be on like a push of the button from like the merchant themselves.
Yeah.
So that fundamentals in mind, we started building, and a couple of things in those fundamentals are really important for us. For example, direct payments, right? If I go to a restaurant and I pay for my food over there, the restaurant owner immediately gets the payout, because I'm the restaurant's customer, and the customer the merchant sold me great food. But on online platforms, that's usually not the case. You pay the platform, and then the platform has a certain type of processing time and certain type of administrative fees, and merchants have to wait for their payout.
Same thing. Oh my God!
Tell me about
it. Sometimes it's so ridiculous. Sorry for interrupting, but sometimes it's so ridiculous. You get a coupon code, right, in your email, for example, at Uber Eats, and it says, okay, 10% off, right? And there's no difference because, you know, it has the delivery fee, the service fee, and then it's one of the same. It doesn't change anything in the price, really.
Yeah, and that happens on like the other side of the coin as well, because you're talking about the consumer perspective, but you have that same dimension over at the merchant perspective. So all these things are basically prohibiting the merchant to do direct to consumer business and basically be in control of their own store. So these fundamentals were very important for us when designing the protocol and designing the system. Same goes with, for example, menu adjustments. When Corona hit the market, there was a lot of restaurants that wanted to adjust their menu because they could only focus on takeaway or delivery. So they had certain types of things on their menu, and they wanted that changed because that shouldn't be on the current live online menu. And even though the image has 3 to 10 days for menu adjustments, we heard stories for up to a couple of weeks. So how crazy is it that a restaurant owner is not able to change their own online menu like on the get-go, on the real time?
Wow.
So all these fundamentals, like every aspect we could think of, like payments, menu adjustments, promotions, maybe even customer loyalty or customer communications, uses of data, or even do refunds, right? Just if a merchant is deciding to do a refund because they drop the ball on a certain type of service level, then it's just in our system, it's just fully automated, and with a push of the button or a click of the button, they can initiate it themselves. And we are still here to provide them with all the insights and all the support and all the features they need, but it's not our job to run their business. It's our job to facilitate their business.
And I think that's the right approach, because what I'm hearing is when restaurant owners are working with Dutch or Uber Eats or Deliveroo, basically they have to sacrifice some certain amount of entrepreneurship. So it's for them pretty difficult to be an entrepreneur while Thuisbezorgd or all these other big players are actually dictating and telling them what to do and not to do.
Exactly. Yeah. And in some cases, even like pay such a high commission fee that on those orders, they're basically losing money. So if you put those two things together, then fundamentally, it's not sustainable for a lot of these restaurants. And if that's not the case, in essence, being sustainable, or in essence, them being the added value added parties in the market, then they should be also be the one earning money on these orders. So that's why we came up with the idea of a protocol, a commerce protocol first, right? The protocol should just facilitate every aspect of their business, and they are in full control.
Yeah, super interesting. So there are a lot of, you know, benefits for restaurant owners. I'm actually asking myself, what's your current go-to-market approach, and how is it different with the competition?
Yeah, so the competition is like they have a tremendous amount of money just to push. We are not in that position quite yet, but we also have a different strategy on it. We really want to grow through ambassador-driven growth. So what currently is happening in the market is we have an association with the Dutch Association of Restaurant Owners, which is basically validating our approach and communicating to their members like, okay, guys, we have an alternative for you. It's in its infancy, it's growing, but we really stand by this project. So that gives us a validity and it gives us communication channels through like an ambassador approach. And same goes for restaurants. So it's really a incentivized or a promoted word-to-word ambassador campaign where restaurants could get benefits for bringing on different restaurants, or users could get additional benefits for bringing on other restaurants. So ambassador-driven and community-driven growth, as well as a different focus on the types of restaurants, because since we have such a flexible system where a restaurant owner could just turn the little knobs and change all the process and parameters for their store, we are also seeing the effect that we have a wider, a wider portfolio of restaurants that are interested. So not just the fast food stuff or the pizza stuff, but also high-level restaurants, because high-level restaurants usually need more parameters or need more variables to be able to serve their products and meals. For example, ordering days ahead and getting your inventory sorted out with like high-quality products, like for example lobster or whatever you can think of, but ordering those ahead for certain types of delivery days in the future, and all those functionalities is currently unique in the market. So that allows us to also target a different type of customer segment.
Yeah, indeed. And also what I've heard is, especially during COVID and the lockdown, there's more demand to, the more luxury food than, just, the burger and the pizza and the pasta. So also do think there's also more demand the more luxury food. So there was a question about payment. So we already briefly touched upon it, but let's expand it a little bit. So how can customers who are using the app, how can they pay? Is it, only through debit card, PayPal, or only crypto?
So currently it's we're working towards a hybrid model first. So the payments are all through a digital payment service provider, which does Ideal, credit card, PayPal, Apple Pay, all the digital stuff, because we need to find a balance between the market readiness for accepting crypto and like our strategic vision of like a crypto with a full peer-to-peer system, right? Because we all know in this crypto space, we are early on, we are innovators, but still a broad segment of like the traditional market is not ready yet for adopting crypto. So what we're doing is facilitating both sides of the coin. The restaurant can choose whatever they would like to accept. But in the future, there might be benefits for using the token. For example, people could get discounts, or merchants could get discounts. So we really want to ease the users into using crypto more and more because of the benefits it will give us as an ecosystem, but also strategically as a technology.
Yeah, this gives a great pass actually for my next question. And the next question, I don't know, Jimmy, sorry, do you have something to...
No, I just wanted to say that it makes sense. And I even believe that a company such as Bistro can even, promote crypto adoption, just by offering this method of payment.
Yeah. And obviously also like the rewards, right? So I mentioned community-driven growth. We want to incentivize that through our token ecosystem. So for example, if you share the data with us for us to optimize our advertising algorithms within the platform, then we could reward data sharing with us like a lot of other projects do. Same thing goes with like merchants. We could like reward merchants, for example, with highly discounted advertisings when they would pay those in tokens. So the use cases we describe on our website and our white paper are all aimed at growing this ecosystem. And the ecosystem is consisting of the platform as well as the community around it. And if we could glue those things together with like the crypto and all its use cases, then we could have a truly truly community driven platform.
Yeah, I like this model very much, and we can see this infographic that you have that describes how this growth model works, right?
Yeah. And yeah, as soon as we have like a bistro.com global utility, then obviously this is where this model is also being applied for global growth. Currently, we are also launching the first ambassador program within the Netherlands this week. It's already starting, those programs are about to be scaled as well when we launch bistro.com.
Got it. Just one note before we continue with the questions. There is a very nice giveaway from Bistro. It's $100 worth of their token, Beast. Unleash the Beast. I love the hashtag on Twitter. So two lucky winners will share this giveaway, and we are going to display during this webinar. We have done it already, and we are going to display again the secret code to unlock the giveaway. It's going to be valid. The giveaway is going to be valid for 24 hours. So you can catch it up in the recording later on. So with that in mind, and you mentioned also we covered the payment methods that you currently have. Tell us a bit about the token, right? What is the utility of the token? Where this beast falls into play?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So we already touched upon a little bit of it. So we have multiple use cases, and they're all aimed at either facilitating the transactions or facilitating the commerce protocol, or either incentivizing the community or incentivizing the merchants to contribute to the platform. So the token will facilitate payments in the future, but potentially also the near future, and we'll be announcing some more information on that in the next few weeks. But also the data rewards, like you see with, for example, Basic Attention Token or numerous amounts of other tokens. When we have an operational platform, people can use our system, and we could utilize the data that they have to optimize the system or optimize the offerings or even personalize the offerings. One unique thing of us is that we will be personalizing your experience as a consumer. Personalization and segmentation needs data, but we want to have the user deliberately allow us to use the data, and in turn we could give them data rewards for it. Same thing goes with like high ratings and reviews. So writing a valued review could help a merchant sell more of its product, or maybe inform the community that a certain product is not up to par. But we want reviews to be like high of quality and genuine. So we came up with a system where the community could value reviews based on upvotes and downvotes, and based on the amount of upvotes in the review, rewards for writing and contributing that valuable information to the ecosystem will go up. So in that case, we try to, even if it's a negative review or the experience was negative, but it's still something that's shared, a shared experience in the community, it could still allow for rewards for contributing that content to the platform. We have a merchant staking model coming up where the merchant could stake their tokens and allow for more discounts on their future operations and be committed to the ecosystem that way. We have shopping opportunities, so they could like order branded stuff like backpacks or bicycles or jackets or even cookingware, cooking ropes, all through like a shopping experience. being highly discounted or even exclusively offered through the token. Same goes with the premium features and the smart advertisings. So that goes two ways. So using the token will be incentivized above like traditional payment methods, because we could do cashbacks or token backs, or we could give discounts based on the token uses. And that's used for consumer ordering, as well as the premium features for merchants, as well as their smart advertising systems. And we already have a community and liquidity staking program currently running. But that's also a way for us to reward and thank the community for contributing to, in this case, liquidity or other staking protocols.
Plenty of use cases, plenty of utilities actually for Beast. That's why you call it Beast, not from Bistro. And if I want to buy the token, where can I buy it? I guess on Uniswap.
Yeah, currently it's traded at Uniswap and HitBTC. We'll be working on some more centralized and decentralized listings in the future. The main portal currently is Uniswap.
Okay, makes sense. Cool. And that's, we have, yeah, sorry.
Yes, I just wanted to add in, that's also where we have the liquidity mining staking currently active.
Got it. Awesome. Let's see, because I think we have a few questions from the people watching us. And I see already the first question was from a friend that is impatiently getting Bistro in Portugal. So he asked, are you available Europe-wide? And he asked Portugal. So I guess, would you like to share some plans? And let's combine this question with another question, where our friend here asks, what are your plans for marketing to go global?
Yeah, yes. People can't wait.
Yeah, that's very good to hear. We took this deliberate approach for the platform to be ready to access this global scale. So we're going to do, like I briefly touched upon earlier, we're going to do our first country expansion this year. And then we'll be launching bistro.com next year fully. But we'll be giving you more insight on the bistro.com concept throughout this year as well, with an extensive concept launch. And the bistro.com instance is our fully platform as a service utility, meaning it has all the support and all the tutorials and all the documentations to basically onboard merchants globally, Europe-wide or globally. And that's also where we were expanding the ambassador programs and expanding the reward and the partners programs in order to really grow it as a platform as a service. And as soon as the platform as a service utility is at the level that we feel confident in doing so, somewhere during next year, then that's where we also become available in Portugal. It's really nice to see that we had a couple of other Portuguese people really rooting for us to come over to Portugal. So I'm definitely taking that into account as we're getting these signals more often. But we're taking a step-by-step approach. The protocol should be ready
I love it because
to scale.
I love it because you are a very down-to-earth person, and you know, whatever you see, and you see another comment here, Germany too. Like you see, people are impatient; they won't be through coming to their town. But I love it how you start. You know, small steps, dream big, and small steps. And
And as long as those steps are validated, then you should be able to do the next one. And currently, our steps are being validated, so we're very happy with that. And we're on to the next challenges in the next couple of months and years. Yeah.
I have a very good question here.
Go for it.
And I think I know the answer, but our friend here says, if Deliveroo and Uber, it's also tokenized, what's your plan to stay alive? I guess the thing here is that Deliveroo and Uber have a totally different business model, right? It's not just to tokenize. They have to change...
Yeah, and they might still do so. And I'm not even sure if it's a bad thing for us, because if they tokenize their business, that would maybe validate our approach even more, being the first to tokenize this business. But the fundamentals we've spoken about in like the very early question, like I think maybe the second question, what makes Bistro different, what differentiates from us, that still holds up, right? That we built this platform as a fundamentally facilitating peer-to-peer platform, even within like all the platform features. And it'll be a big and complicated transition for them to also do those features like that. So yeah, I guess that'll be my answer. I'm not sure if it will be a bad thing if they tokenize. Maybe it validates our approach even more, but fundamentally the platforms are built different.
Makes sense. Can I ask you a small favor, Bas? Can you share your screen with us and show us a bit of the user interface of Bistro? Because I'm very...
Yes, sure. But keep in mind that we have a big user interface update coming up, which we dubbed Bistro Core V4, version 4,
okay,
which will be released throughout this quarter. So I invite everyone to come to our channels and stay on top of these publications, because there's a big breakdown coming out. So I'll show you the current live product and how people will order and how the process goes, how fluent it goes. But mm-hmm. Please keep in mind that we have a very big update coming up, which is pretty sexy in terms of
actually UI, yeah, and I mean, UX updates. You are a startup. You started a bit more than a year ago. So we are talking and you plan to revolutionize food delivery industry. So we have high expectations of Bistro, but that doesn't mean that, I will see everything in the platform. You know, with development, everything comes with iteration. I have worked with developers before. I know how product management works. So it's fine. It's fine. I really love Bistro. So...
Cheers. Yeah. But for us, stability and like usability was always very important. So I think we already have like a very nice and clean product, and we keep hearing that from our merchants and our clients as well. But like you said, we keep iterating and we keep improving. So let me figure out how I could share. Okay, share my screen.
Let me remove my screen, and once you are ready, I will
give me
add
second.
Your screen in the live stream. So in the meantime, you can see that you can access the giveaway from the link in the live stream description. I have displayed the code to unlock the giveaway, and I'm going to do it again. And the giveaway will be active for 24 hours, so you can watch the recording to get the code. Yes, we haven't made it easy.
Yeah. And by the way, I already have the app on my iPhone, and it works like a charm, to be honest. Also, like the pictures and the food, nice interface. So.
Okay, then maybe it's a good idea, because I'm running into like a technical issue. I'm using a new device, and it's asking me to provide like authorizations for Brave Browser to actually share my screen. But okay. In order to do so, I have to close Brave Browser. So we'll lose the connection when I do so. So maybe could you run us through the application, Jimmy, or I could. Maybe I could pull it also up on my phone. Maybe that's the best way to
wait,
do it.
I can go to bistro.nl.
Yeah, so that's a bit of a technical issue. I could do so, but then I'll jump out of the live stream back and get back in.
No need to do that.
We have this is the...
There you go.
Let me put it in.
Yes.
Yeah. So hopefully it's clear for you guys. Like, I'll have to do it in like reverse. So bear with me. The cool thing about our platform is that it's all about like experience, right? So we allow the merchants to basically translate their experience and control all these stuff within the application. Nice. For example, the images. Let me click down on this. The images and all the descriptions and all the pricing and all the way they structure their I'm still here. The way they structure their store is all in their hands through the back office. And yeah, we'll be showing you the new back office within the updates. But a very like also unique thing about us is we don't only have meals. So we also have like grocery type and specialty type products for you to enjoy at home. So in the Netherlands, these are already nationwide available. And for example, we're currently looking at a spices store where they sell sambal and ketchup. So stuff you can use as a home cook or as a home foodie that is like direct from the source. So this is a guy who is importing this stuff and creating these recipes directly from Indonesia and selling them to your doorstep in the Netherlands. So without like a supermarket or anything in between. So that's the direct to consumer dimension we would really love to facilitate. In some cases, this also entails home cooks or bakery services. So we have people, as long as you are legally allowed to sell food, then we want to facilitate you.
That's but lovely, actually.
Some legalities that they need to take into account. For example, regulations on hygiene and all that kind of stuff.
That's lovely, actually, because you allow more people to get in, not just food stores. And we have this question, actually, from Bianca. Is this true also for the home cook and bakery service to sell on your site? So you just answered that.
Yeah, cheers. Yeah, that's correct. So as long as they're legally allowed to sell food, then we would like to facilitate them.
Great. And I have our friend here, Cryptok, who asked about what will happen if Deliveroo, for example, tokenizes. And he insists, he follows up with another question. And he says, thanks for the answer, but there again, if you are successful, Deliveroo and Uber will probably try to buy you out at some point. How strong will you hold on not selling? I guess it's about the exit plan here, right?
Yeah, I guess so. So in essence, it might be good like to collaborate with these parties or if we get to a certain level that they cannot ignore us any further, then obviously there might be opportunities in collaboration or maybe even utilizing our technology within their dynamics, but that's just way ahead of us. I don't think I can give a great answer to a question like that, because we're just focused on building our protocol as the unique protocol it is. Currently, our only focus is onboarding big restaurant chains and a lot of restaurants and a lot of like home cook or specialty stores. And just build the community out with the token as well as with the protocol and the infrastructure. So I haven't even been basically thinking about these types of questions at this point.
I like it. And one thing, because I have worked with many entrepreneurs here in London, by the way, when you decide to come to London, please speak to me. It's one thing that I don't like with new businesses is that we have an entrepreneur, he starts a business with an exit plan already in mind. I don't like the idea. And there are books also that recommend that. You know, you start your business having an exit plan in your mind. I don't like it because you decide to give birth to a child, right? And by it's kind of... It doesn't make sense if you think before you give birth or you give birth right away. I mean, in the first years, you think when the kid will go to college to get rid of it, right?
Yeah. I see what you're getting at. And like, it's just a step-by-step approach, right? We are just focused on building a good product, a good protocol, and building something that's unique in the market and satisfactory service our merchants and satisfactory service our clients, and that's the end goal, and grow it as big as we can.
Makes sense. Probably a technical question, and please, Jimmy, feel free to jump in if you have any questions. What company is behind the payment system for Bistro?
Yeah, so currently we're using Morley.com as a payment service provider. And we keep thinking about like other possibilities. We are also looking into like crypto payment providers, obviously, to integrate as soon as we can. So the payment service providing market is also a market that is growing tremendously, and some of these companies are a little bit like crypto oriented, and some of them are definitely not. So we keep focusing on like what partner is good for us in the future. But currently we're using Molly.com.
Yeah, Molly.com is pretty well-known and well-respected in Europe, especially in the Netherlands.
Most important thing for us, like choosing them, was the automated direct payments. So if a merchant gets an order, they immediately receive the money as well. And that was one of the biggest prerequisites for us when choosing the payment provider, like initially, the first one we used, yeah.
Yeah, it makes sense. It also shows that you really think thoroughly about any decisions you make to build up Bistro. There is an interesting question from Klaus. We all know that, you know, blockchain and DLT is all about decentralization. So how far decentralized will you go, is asking Klaus. Possible decision power for token holders?
Yeah, so we already have been thinking a lot about governance models. However, we have not implemented one right now. It might still be a possibility in the future, especially when we work toward Bistro.com as more of a utility protocol being available everywhere. With the Bistro.com concept launch, we'll be going more into depth on how decentralized we will be going on, for example, areas like development or areas of like contributions in growth, marketing, sales, all that kind of stuff, as well as potentially decision making. But for now, the project would not, like, currently I don't think it would benefit because like in the short term, but in the long term we are definitely considering it, and we have been considering it already a lot historically. But yeah, step by step, we'll go further into decentralization, and the Bistro.com concept launch, which will happen in a few months, will elaborate more on that.
Yeah, that's the way to go, step by step. There's also another question. I think this one is also quite interesting. So we already, you know, talked about, paying with Ideal and, you know, the default, payment providers. We also talked about BIS, you know, that people can buy their food with, you know, with use of the BIS tokens.
Exactly.
Are also any ideas to, you know, use other cryptos as a payment?
Yes, for sure. And also that will be communicated more in depth over the following weeks. So we are currently in the process of integrating, or at least setting up our integration plan and setting up the integration priorities if you look at like different type of cryptos. But it's definitely our plan to have more cryptos accepted as a means of payment. And the first ones will be going live this year, potentially or highly likely even this quarter.
Well, that's exciting. That's exciting because I'm pretty sure that a lot of people, they are willing to, you know, to use their crypto to give it extra utility by ordering food.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we currently are looking at a lot of these other projects that are doing a marketplace dimension and have integrated crypto as a means of payment, and also integrated multiple cryptos as a means of payment. And we would like to follow their example. So more details on that, like in a few weeks, but we're currently working on it.
Yeah, that's good. You guys are, you know, you keep building, and that's good, and it shows. So, you know, talking about building and milestones, I think one of your next milestones is, you know, the new upgrade of the website,
exactly,
or the app.
Yeah.
And what will be the next milestone in your project, is asking Paul.
Yeah, so like the biggest one you touched upon is the V4 update, the version 4 update, which is like being the fundamentals of becoming a platform as a service in like the next layer of fundamentals, of the technical fundamentals. So that's a major one, and that is happening throughout this quarter. And then next quarter we'll be doing the expansion, the first country expansion, which is going to be a big milestone for us, because it's the first time we'll go beyond the Dutch borders, and validating that expansion approach is going to be very important for us. And then the other major big release and major like milestone is going to be the launch of bistro.com next year as a fully platform as a service protocol. Big timeline.
Those are the biggest. I guess the .com version will be, as you said, software or platform as a service, to be more exact. So people will just, merchants will be able to go there and build their store from scratch, no matter where they are, right?
Yeah, so throughout next year, it's going to be, is our goal to launch it like that. And we'll be, the remainder of this year, we'll be taking people further into the concept. So what does that entail? How do I say it? What dimensions should be in place, or what modules should be in place to actually fully facilitate bistro.com as a borderless utility? So we're gonna keep people interested and informed about the process, how we will get there, but it's gonna be somewhere next year.
Nice. And I have one question that we haven't covered. And when it comes to crypto projects or blockchain projects, everyone is looking the fundamentals, right? Would you like to share some information about the team and the background, so the experience they have in development, blockchain development? Because yes, Actually the team really matters.
It does. Yeah, it does. Yeah. So like I've been obviously talking about my experience and my education, as well as like the work experience I had afterwards. So when I worked at EY, I saw a lot of like big corporate digital process environments, and I learned a lot from that, the way we could digitally organize process management or process execution. My co-founder Bob Doman is our CTO. He's been a developer for over 12 years, if I recall correctly. Let me double check. Maybe it's even a little bit more, but he's been responsible for like projects from A to Z on the technical level as well, for big brands in the Netherlands. For example, he did supply chain management optimizations for big furniture companies. And Bob and me basically co-founded the entire project. So yeah, you can obviously look at the team on the website and see everyone's LinkedIn as well. We co-founded the project. We launched it together with Bas Gele as being our marketing and creative director. So he's been responsible for getting a good brand out there and getting the tone of voice nailed down and even optimized even further. Michel Brandt is a very senior sales and account manager who has scaled startups before. In his case, in the logistical area, which is obviously very relevant for us as soon as we become more and more dispersed throughout Europe. Logistics is going to be a big challenge for us as well. So, and obviously we have hired a couple of very experienced and very passionate, especially developers and technical guys that are helping us build the product to the next level. And from an advisory perspective, we have been working together with Matt Lusinski from Travala.com, which is basically very relevant experience, since Travala.com is also doing a certain similar thing, but in a different market. And we've been working closely with Chris Daw from like the initiation of the project. Chris being an amazing entrepreneur located in the Netherlands as well. So I've been working with him from the get-go. He's the founder of Effector.ai.
Well, this is what I call a team.
Impressive.
We're still working towards more people. Yeah. So currently we are in the hiring process on like development, sales, marketing, all those divisions.
Yeah. Sometimes when you're going to a crypto project and you click on a team, you just see a bunch of
just names or not even pictures of the real people behind the real project. But this is you cover basically everything from IT to logistics. It's pretty impressive, if you ask me.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I have one question when it comes to Bistro, how it works, the overall process. So if I order from Bistro some food and I have complaints, right?
Yeah.
I can raise this complaint, let's say, to the merchant. It will go directly to the merchant, I assume. Are you involved in the process in any way, you know, if there is no resolution?
Yeah, so we provide the support on that level. So they can directly contact the merchant, and basically it's also the responsibility of the merchant, but we facilitate that relationship. So if the merchant needs support from us, the merchant will reach out and we can help them do a refund, or we can help them give out voucher codes or promotional codes. But in essence, they could all do those things themselves. But sometimes they need to find their way a little, because after a couple of months, they'll get their first complaint, and then they contact us, and then they want some more information on how to handle it. But they are definitely completely able to do so themselves. So merchants can do a full refund. They can do partial refunds. They could give a discount on like the next orders. They could even get into contact with the client directly. And all those things are basically also unique features that they don't have with the traditional current platforms in the market. So it's the responsibility of the merchant to basically nurture the relationship with their consumer, even if that consumer had a negative experience for a certain or at a certain time. And we help them achieve to do so.
And that is sensible, right? Because if I go in store, if I dine in, then
exactly,
it's the same. The owner or the waitress,
exactly,
or the waiter are responsible to facilitate, to nurture this relationship with the
customers. Exactly.
And
it's basically the only way you could actually build loyalty. And that opportunity is taken away from them in a lot of these other platform service providers or platforms.
And we keep getting these questions, Bas, around where if Bistro is going.
Yes,
if Bistro is only available in the Netherlands.
Plans, but currently, it's only available in the Netherlands. And we're going to go to Belgium later this year, and Europe and global next year.
It's the third time you're saying it, but it's great.
But
to see
I like getting this question though.
Yeah,
it's one of the most most interesting questions to have, because this signals interest, and we are always happy with enthusiasm.
Exactly, it's great to see all this excitement from people, and I can see that Cryptalk is a fan of you, very interested. So he has another question: if you have plans to expand in other services like Gojek, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, in Indonesia, where you can order all sorts of things, going from groceries, massages, rides, etc.
Yeah. So I touched upon this a little earlier when I showed the application. Obviously, we already have groceries or specialty products from producers or small local markets, or even directly from farmers. We're selling meat, we're selling fresh vegetables, we're selling fish directly from like the fish markets in the Netherlands. We have specialty products like wine, cheeses. So we're already active in the grocery business within the Netherlands, and we can deliver those within the entirety of the Netherlands as well to one of our partners. Thanks Cryptalk for these questions though, and we might expand into different markets as well, because the essence of this is the protocol, and the protocol could be utilized in different markets in the future. But we really want to nail the food markets first. So groceries as well as prepared meals, to really, really prove the power of our protocol and our technology. But it's not a weird thing to ask that we might become active in different markets as well in the future.
Got it. And yeah, you can see the excitement keeps on, right? Another friend of ours, if you expand globally, will you start having offices around the world?
Yeah, potentially. But again, this is also where we would really like have ambassadors and community-driven growth. So yeah. How are we exactly going to organize these hubs, being outside of the Netherlands or even being outside of Europe? We'll specify that in a later stage. But the community and ambassador-driven growth is what's most important, and how we will nurture those relationships or nurture those dynamic within different countries is going to be specified at a later stage.
Get it. And we have one last question before we wrap up. And let me know, Jim, if you have any questions as well for Bas. So how are you going to check whether merchants are allowed to sell food in other countries outside the Netherlands? Very good question, I think.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so each country will have a sort of registration, business registration or health regulation registration, like hygienic certificates, I have to say. So for each country, we will have to have a approach that is aimed at like what's available within the country. But that will also entail quality assurance checks from our side, as well as moderation. But we'll have to be very careful. And I think it's a very good question. But I think it's really dictated by the country themselves. So when we launch in a certain country or make the utility available in a certain country, we'll have those things figured out and ready to go.
You will know the regulation of each country, so they will have
exactly.
I guess, to submit
for me, the
relevant.
For me, it's now really complicated to answer this for every country in the world, but like step by step, each country will figure it out, and we're currently working on Belgium for this.
Makes sense. Jimmy, any questions for our
Yeah,
friend Bas?
Just like one last question. So, Bas, what I'm seeing, what I'm hearing is there is this expansion drift, this motivation to expand and to take over the world, basically, and to compete with the big players. So how would you envision Bistro within, let's say, 5 years from now?
That's a good question. And obviously, that touches upon ambition a lot. Yeah, so our vision is like, I might sound a little bit repetitive on this, but our vision is actually being the protocol, right? It should be plug and play. So if it's plug and play, and then we should be available globally within like the next 5 years, as long as regulation allows us to be. So that's definitely a nuance I'll have to mention. But in five years, it's definitely going to be a global utility, active in numerous of countries, where we are allowed to operate.
That sounds ambitious, and I'm pretty sure you guys will achieve that. And well, at least you have me as a customer, because I've
yes,
seen
thank you, Jimmy.
In the app.
Hopefully we can have you as an ambassador as well. But
yeah, even as an ambassador, because yeah. There are some merchandisers that are they're selling fish, salmon, high quality salmon. I'm a personally big fan of high quality salmon, so that's a good match at least.
Yeah, cheers. Yeah, and we're expanding merchants basically daily at this point, and hopefully we'll pick up even more steam on onboarding merchants as soon as the utility is ready to scale internationally. And that's what we're really working on. We are working hard on currently. So if you have any suggestions or any local gems for if you talk about merchants, then please let us know, and we'll be happy to reach out.
Yeah, sure, we will do so. Yes,
awesome. Okay, any last words from you, Bas? I guess we have to wrap this up. So Bistro,
a word. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
It is a pleasure. I think it was a great chat, and thank you for providing all this clarity around Bistro. And just to remind people, Bistro.io uses blockchain to give the power to food stores, to merchants directly, and to customers, lowers the fees for them, and will change the way we order food, I guess, in the near future.
Exactly. Yeah, we're already doing it in the Netherlands, but we'll be available in all the other countries that people have been asking around as soon as we can.
Great. And to close with this, how we can find you, like Twitter, Telegram. We have your Twitter link, the Bistrus Twitter, on the description.
Yeah, so Twitter is definitely the most important for you to follow and like and interact with, like, the newest announcements coming out. And we would like to welcome you in our Telegram for an open discussion and any suggestions or any questions or just to stay on top of the developments as well. So we have a Bistro Telegram. Maybe we could link the Telegram somewhere, the link as well. But
I will add it in the description after.
Cheers. Well, the Twitters and Telegram is definitely where we are most active. And we have obviously other channels like Medium. So if you go to our website, bistro.io, then you can find all the channels over there as well. But it would be good to share those specific channels as well.
Fantastic. Unleash the beast then.
Unleash the beast, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Thank cheers. You very much for your time, Bas. We will keep it that. Thank you so much for dedicating the time in this live stream. And you, Jimmy, as well, for co-hosting this live stream.
Thanks for having me. And thanks to the community for all those great questions and the attendance.
Awesome. Speak soon. Cheers. Take care. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.